So, what we're going to be focusing on this class is really a five-step valuation process. And over the next few weeks, we're going to be going through these steps. Right? So, the first step is, in order to predict the future and value a company, we have to have a better understanding of the historical performance of the firm. So that's really what today is going to be about. It's about thinking about the historical performance and rearranging the financial statements into an economic format. Right? Then what we're going to focus on is forecasting the financial statements, because we're going to have to forecast the cash flows, and ultimately we're going to forecast the economic statements. But at some point, it's going to be too difficult to keep forecasting into the future. Because, like I said, in 20, 30 years, who knows what sales and profits are going to be for a company. So what we're going to do is we're going to then stop forecasting, and then we're going to define what's called a continuing value period. So the difference between a project and a company is companies are assumed to last forever. So we have to forecast financials forever. So that's why we're going to do the continuing value period. Typically, we'll go out between 5 and 15 years of defined forecasts. Then we'll stop and we'll do the period after that into perpetuity as continuing value. That's where we'll use the key value driver formula. Right? Once we've done that, we'll have to bring everything back to a present value. So we'll have to figure out what an appropriate cost of capital is to discount all these cash flows. And then we'll have to take the equity value of the firm, or sorry, the enterprise value of the firm, and bring it back to an equity value or a share price and make sense of our results. And that's really the process that we're going to be teaching in this class. Now, there are various models for forecasting cash flows. The book refers to several of them. And this semester, you're going to be responsible for the first two. Right? So there's going to be two methodologies for valuing companies using a cash flow basis I'm going to teach you. One is called the Enterprise Discounted Cash Flow Method, or Enterprise DCF for short. It is the most commonly used method out there in the world today. It's the one that you're going to run into if you actually go out there and do this professionally. Right? But as an alternative to that, I'm also going to show you the discounted economic profit model, or essentially it's a spread-based model, EVA-based model. Right? And your final exam, I'll just let you know today, all your exams in this class are open book, open notes. Right? So the midterm exam is going to be on converting the statements. Right? The final exam is going to be, I'm going to give you forecasted financials, and you're going to tell me what the share price should be using those first two methods. And your answer has to equal. If it equals, you'll do well on your final exam. If it doesn't equal, not so well. Right? Because the point is that the value of a company should not change because our methodology for valuing it is different. Right? So the value of the company is not going to change. It's the way we arrive at that value. It's going to be a different process. Right? And so mathematically, what we're going to prove in this class is if you use different methodologies, you still come up with the same answer. Right? So changing your methodology doesn't change the value of the company. So therefore, enterprise DCF and discounted economic profit have to give you the same answer. Matter of fact, if you use an APV, adjusted present value method, you have to get the same answer. If you use the capital cash flow method or an equity valuation model method, you have to get the same answer. Right? The reason why there are so many different models is because that's what it takes to get a PhD today in finance. So to get a PhD, you have to prove that you've created new knowledge. Well, they've allowed that definition to mean that if you rearrange formulas in a different way than they've been rearranged and get the same answer, then that qualifies for creating knowledge. So therefore, that's why you have all these different methodologies. Because you got a lot of PhDs in finance that need their PhDs, and it's an easy way to get there. Right? So again, a lot of these methods give you the same results. The question is there a lot of value in doing those results? So that's why we're not going to focus on those other methods, because some of them are very specialized and have value in a specialized way, and some of them are just, I think, just academic and are not used in the real world. So for example, APV, adjusted present value, the way that you're going to run into that is if you work for a private equity firm. Because what APV does is it measures the value of the interest tax shield, and it measures the value of changes in capital structure. So for most firms that don't change their capital structure, APV is overkill. because basically if I try and value the capital structure doesn't change. Well, I got some interesting information that's not going to really change, not really a lot of difference in understanding the value of the firm. But if I'm a private equity firm and I'm taking a firm private, I'm loading it up with debt, and I'm getting rid of a lot of equity, then valuing that capital structure makes a lot of sense because I have to outweigh that with the additional financial risk I'm adding from loading the firm up with a lot of debt. So that's who uses APV. Same thing. If I take a firm public that I've previously had private and I'm now loading it up with equity and paying off the debt, am I taking advantage of that in the process? So APV is really when I change the capital structure dramatically, what's the impact of that on the firm's value? The capital cash flow model is basically a model where you take all the cash flows and you leave them lumped together. So in this class, we have operating cash flows, non-operating cash flows, and debt cash flows. And a lot of what we're going to spend time on today is breaking them out so we can analyze the firm based on each of those three areas. The capital cash flow model just lumps all three together. And it says if you leave all three lumped together, you get the same valuation as if you split them apart. But I'm saying in the real world, no one does that, because leaving them all together doesn't give you any insight into what the firm's really doing. So it's great in the academic world, but I've, to be honest with you, never seen anyone in the real world even think about using that model. And then the fourth model is equity cash flow, or fifth model is equity cash flows, which is basically what you use to do a bank or financial services company. And primarily because if you think about a bank, interest for a bank is operating because they have interest income. The interest you pay them on your loans is revenue for them. They have the cost of funding their loans. Interest expense is a cost of doing business. So for a bank, interest is operating. But interest is also finance, because banks also finance themselves with debt to fund their operations, not just to fund their loans. So with a bank, interest is tricky, because some of it is operating and some of it is financing. But if I do a company like Chipotle, all of their interest is financing. They don't use interest to run their actual stores. So for manufacturing service firms, it's clean with interest. For banks, it's not so clean. So what people do is, because it's hard, what they'll do is they'll just treat just the equity cash flows and not the cash flows to the debt and the equity holders, because debt cash flow is proxy for interest. So that's the point. With a bank, where I mix in my cash flows for interest, it doesn't make sense. It's harder to break out those debt cash flows. So when you value a bank, you don't. You leave them in there, and then you see what's left, and it's the cash flows to the equity holders. Whereas if you do Chipotle, it's the cash flow available to the debt and the equity holders. That's the enterprise DCF method. Again, you could theoretically use enterprise DCF for a bank. It's just much more difficult to do, because you got to figure out which interest is really operating and which interest is really financing. And again, it's so hard to do in a bank that companies don't do it, which is why they use the equity cash flow method. So again, those last few methodologies are just specialized method for valuation. Matter of fact, the dividend cash flow method evaluation, the Gordon dividend model, is really just about a variation of the equity cash flow method. So again, there's just various variations. We're going to focus on the top two. So what's important to understand about enterprise DCF? First, the primary driver of enterprise DCF is free cash flow, and that's going to drive the operating cash flow of the firm. Another important thing about enterprise DCF is that the cash flows are going to be discounted at a WACC, because we're going to assume a constant capital structure for a firm. So essentially, we're going to assume a constant target capital structure, and therefore, that's going to give us a constant WACC for our discount cash horizon. So we're not going to vary the discount rate year by year. It gets too difficult to try and forecast. And so therefore, enterprise DCF is the one that you're already intimately familiar with, because it's based in NPV. And so that's why it's actually so popular, because it's really just doing a glorified NPV, right? Whereas the economic profit model is based on spread, and the difference between the two models is where the DCF, which is NPV, just tells you whether or not you're creating value. Economic profit tells you when the value is being created. So that's really the additional insight you get with the second model that you don't get from an NPV. So with the NPV, you know you generate cash flow. The question is, does that cash flow create value? You only know in total. You don't know period by period. So the economic profit model gives you a period by period view of whether the cash flow is adding or subtracting to the overall NPV of the project. And so that's really what's different about the spread-based model. NPV looks at total. Spread looks at period by period. Change in value of the firm. So if you add the period-by-period values, you get the overall change in value of the firm. That's the NPV. That's the enterprise DCF. That's why they have to eventually balance. So let's talk a little bit of NPV-based DCF approach. Generally, assuming in this simple graphical illustration we don't have any non-operating assets, then the operating value of the firm, the free cash flows, summed and discounted, give us the enterprise value of the firm. Assuming that we take the enterprise value and we pay it to the debt and the equity holders, then all of the payments to the debt holders become the debt value. Equity is a residual. That's why it will ultimately balance. It equals all the equity payments. And so basically we'll take all of the money that's going to the debt and the equity equals the same thing as all the money that was available from the free cash flow, which was the enterprise value of the firm. The advantage of this approach is that it's additive. So therefore, let's say I'm valuing a multi-business firm. Then what I can do is I can value each of the businesses independently and add them together, right? Because NPV can be added together. I can add two NPVs together. So it gives me a lot of flexibility with this approach. So I can do a sum of the parts valuation. So in this case, if a company had three businesses, I value the businesses separately, I add them together. If the company had a corporate center that wasn't generating revenue, I could just subtract off the corporate center to get an overall value of the operations. If the company did have non-operating assets, I add in the non-operating asset value. That gets me the enterprise value. I pay off all the debt from the enterprise value. Equity is the residual value. Divide by shares, share price. That is the process that we're about to go through for an enterprise DCF valuation. In the book, McKinsey did a sample valuation of Home Depot. I'm skipping a few slides because I know you read the book. So basically, this chart that you see, we're going to use and rely on pretty heavily because this is actually going to show up as a tab in the Excel models that you are going to start to build. Okay? So matter of fact, for Tuesday's class, we're going to start building out the valuation model. So in Tuesday's class, Monday's class, if I show up on Tuesday, nobody else does, then it's going to really be a class. So in Monday's class, thank you, we're going to start building out the valuation model. So you'll really need to use a computer in Monday's class. I strongly recommend bringing one. So back to this. Basically, if we think about this, we have to forecast out the cash flows for the company in the future. So we're going to start out with the operating values. So what McKinsey did for Home Depot at the time the book was written in 2008 is they were forecasting Home Depot from 2009 forward. So they created the forecast years, 2009 through 2018, and then they forecasted the free cash flow year by year for each one of those years. They then estimated a cost of capital for Home Depot, a WACC of 8.5%, based on the weighted average cost of capital at the time. And so that created these discount factors. So if we discount all of those free cash flows at that WACC, then we get these present values of the free cash flows. Starting in 2019, they defined that as the continuing value period. Because when they were forecasting year by year, it started to get too hard to forecast year by year. So starting in 2019, so 2019 forward, Home Depot obviously was going to continue operating its stores. So they had to come up with a value for 2019 forward. So using the key value driver formula, they put the assumptions in and created a value for the firm from 2019 forward, growing perpetuity at that point. Discounted that to present value, came up with a present value of the free cash flows for the continuing value period, added them, since they're all in present value, to the first 10 years, and that became the overall operating value of the firm. So basically, the value of Home Depot stores, selling stuff in their stores at the time, was $62.694 billion based on those cash flows coming true. Now, McKinsey then did a step, which we're not going to do in this class, but academically it does make sense to do. Right? But in the real world, people don't always do all the steps in here. So I'll just let you know when people are taking some shortcuts, and this is a shortcut people often take and don't use. But what they did is they added in the concept of a mid-year adjustment factor. And here's the point of the mid-year adjustment factor. is that Home Depot doesn't actually get all of its cash flows on December 31st. If you think about the way present value works, present value takes the cash flow at the end of the year and brings it to the value at the beginning of the year. So when we're present valuing all those free cash flows, we're assuming that all the cash flows occur in December, and then we're valuing them in January. Well, that's not realistic because Home Depot is generating cash every day. So what they do is they use the mid-year adjustment factor where they say, if cash was evenly earned throughout the year, then what they really should do is move the entire model to June 30th or July 1st. So move it to the six-month period of the year. So what they do is they future value the whole valuation 6 months forward. And that's what they call the mid-year adjustment factor, to basically account for time value money that the cash is earned throughout the year. So that's what they're doing here. They're multiplying it by the about 0.5 power of the discount rate to basically get a mid-year adjustment factor. So therefore, they get a mid-year value of about $65 billion. So they're saying if we kind of adjust for a limitation of present value, it would actually add almost $2.6 billion of value to Home Depot, which at 1.7 billion shares is about $1.60, $1.80 a share. So again, it does make a difference, right? But as I said, practically, I see very few people in the real world actually doing this, right? But you can if you choose, right? So again, that gets me the operating value, 65,291. Then we add in the non-operating value of the business. So they add in the value of excess cash. They add in the value of any long-term investments they have in other companies. So for example, companies make minority investments in other businesses, get a value of that. And they add in the value of any tax loss carryforwards. Add the non-operating items in, that gets you your enterprise value of 65,764. Then you pay off the debt and what are called the debt equivalents. So you look up all the interest-bearing debt in the balance sheet, 11,434. But what's interesting about Home Depot is they have some off-balance sheet debt. You only find this in the footnotes, right? But if you actually read the footnotes, which is great for insomnia, then what ends up happening is you notice that Home Depot leases a lot of stores. And if you look at their non-cancelable operating leases, they are committing to an additional $8.298 billion of lease financing because they don't own these stores in the shopping malls. They often lease a lot of these. And therefore, that's debt that has to be paid off before the shareholders get paid. So really, you have what is called hidden debt or debt equivalent debt that we all set to find for companies. And the two most common forms of off-balance sheet debt for companies are leases and unfunded pension liabilities. So if companies have big unfunded pension liabilities where they promise their employees future benefits and they don't have the cash set aside, then that's a debt equivalent. Right? So we have to make sure that that's not debt to a bank, it's debt to the employee, but it's still something that has to be accounted for. And again, the government has said that companies can't have unfunded pension liabilities in the future, but in the short run, they can still create them. So particularly in the defense and aerospace industry as an example, in 2008, where they have a lot of pensions. In 2008, the stock market crashed. Well, that left a lot of those defense and aerospace pensions well underfunded, and it created huge liabilities in the short run for a lot of those companies that eventually, because the pension assets went down, the value of their equity went down, and the liabilities didn't change to the employees. So again, that's kind of a debt by proxy that the companies have. So those are the two most common form of debt equivalents we're going to try and identify for a company. Once we pay those off, we're then left with an equity value divided by shares outstanding, share price. Right? That's the process, right, for the firm. So it's actually a relatively straightforward process for equity valuation. That's enterprise DCF. Now let me talk about method number two, which is the economic profit method. So again, economic profit is spread. It's defined in the book. We gave an example of it last week. But here's how you do this. You forecast the balance sheet. And that gives you a forecast of what we're going to call invested capital. Right? And very important, in order to get these two to match up, you have to use what's called beginning of year invested capital. So the forecast for invested capital as of January 1, not December 31. Okay, so we're going to call that BOY invested capital, as opposed to EOY, which stands for end of year. Right, but in order for these two methods to match up mathematically, you have to use the starting or beginning of year invested capital. So this is the beginning of year forecast invested capital for Home Depot going forward for the same period of time. You then forecast an ROIC, because you're forecasting the profits divided by the invested capital, for the company using beginning of year invested capital. So NOPLAT for the year divided by beginning of year invested capital. Forecast ROICs. Same WACC that we used in the enterprise DCF. So we now have a concept of spread. Forecasted ROIC, forecasted WACC, forecasted beginning of year capital from the balance sheet. That spread, ROIC minus WACC times invested capital, equals the economic profit. So we're forecasting a dollar-based economic profit, or EVA, for the firm each and every year. We discount those spreads. It's discount the economic profits at the same cost of capital, so we get a present value of the economic profits. So again, the economic profit is the period-by-period change in value. We just discount that and add it up. So in the first 10 years, the change in value of Home Depot is the sum of those 10 items. There's another formula, a variation of the continuing key value driver formula, which says we also want to forecast the spreads in continuing value. So we forecast the spreads from 2019 forward, just and use a perpetuity for that to present value that. And so this is the value from 2019 forward of the spreads. So this is the change in value for the defined period. This is the change in value for the continuing value period. Sum them up. This is the change in value for the business. Add that to the beginning or current invested capital. So right now, as of the end of 2008, start of 2009, Home Depot had $37 billion of invested capital on its balance sheet. Based on the forecast of the financial statement, it's going to add a cumulative $25.6 billion to its operations by generating a positive spread. Those two together add up to an operating value $62,694. And that number should sound familiar, because 62,694 of operating value is the same as the 62,694 of operating value given the DCF method. Right? And that's really what's going to be key to these two methods, is to get those numbers to be the same. Okay? So I'll briefly mention this, but there is method number three. And that is APV. Book does talk about APV. And like I said, we're not going to do APV, but what I told you a few minutes ago is that if you do APV, you should get the same answer as if you did the enterprise DCF. Right? So here's the point. If you do an adjusted present value, use the same free cash flows in the forecast that you did in doing the enterprise DCF. So you forecast the free cash flows, you use the same free cash flow forecast. The difference is you also forecast the interest tax shields. Interest tax shields is going to be basically the tax rate times the interest. It's what you can write off and not pay to the government because of the tax deductibility of the debt. So you forecast the interest tax shields. You discount the free cash flows and the interest tax shields at a cost of equity, not a weighted average cost of capital. Right, because you're looking at essentially a higher discount rate that makes the cash flows worth a little less. So at the higher cost of equity, specifically an unlevered cost of equity, right, you would discount the free cash flows and the interest tax shields. That gets you a present value of the free cash flows and a present value of the interest tax shields. You also forecast those into continuing value. And when you add those two present values up, you get the same operating value for the firm. So that's what I'm saying. If you use the methods and you do it correctly, you actually get the same value for the firm. But now you get a little bit different insight. So three methods, three questions. First question. How much value from operations does Home Depot create? What's the answer to that question? Yeah, $65 billion if we use the mid-year adjustment factor. Let's, for simplicity, let's not use it. $62,694. Right? Question two. When does Home Depot create the value? We don't really know that with DCF. We can kind of eyeball and guess it. But that's actually the difference we have with the economic profit model. But here's the other question we can answer with the economic profit model. How much value was added to the original investment? So how much did Home Depot originally put into their business? $37 billion. That's the invested capital. And how much value was added? $25 billion. If we do enterprise DCF, we don't know that. We just know the total NPV. We don't know what was spent over time cumulatively and how much value was added. Because maybe what's happening to the business is the reason the business is becoming more valuable is just because they're putting more assets into the business. And they're not adding value to the assets. They're just making the assets bigger because they're just growing their business. We can see that differentiation with a spread-based model. Matter of fact, Stern Stewart calls that difference of 25,619 market value added, MVA. How much value you've added to the invested capital. Okay. Question, actually I said three, this is really the fourth question, but the final question, how much value does Home Depot have by having debt in their capital structure? What's the subsidy from the U.S. government for them having debt? $9.4 billion. So basically, Home Depot is taking advantage of a tax shield of $9.4 billion. So if you've been reading the headlines since the election, Obama said, we want to raise taxes on the wealthy. And the Republicans have said, we will not raise the tax rates, but what are we willing to consider? Eliminating deductions. Basically, this is what they're going after. That this is the subsidy to individual Americans, if you think of it as a proxy, on the interest deduction on your mortgage. Right? Because you save taxes that otherwise would have gone to the government because they let you deduct your mortgage. So one of the things that's going to be discussed in Congress in the next 2 weeks is for high-income taxpayers, you make over $200,000, can't deduct the interest on your mortgage anymore. Well, in a way, that's taking back a subsidy that the government's giving to you. Corporations are the same way. Corporations issue debt. They get to write off the debt at the tax rate that they pay, the interest on that debt. And so that's a subsidy. Home Depot, by having debt, gets $9.4 billion worth of subsidy. Right? So that's the value. Home Depot would be worth $9.4 billion less if they didn't have debt. Okay? Given the taxes. Because that money would go to who? Go to the government. So this is actually what the private equity firms do. I want to issue new debt. I look at how much tax shield I create. Then I look at how much risk is associated with that debt, and then I do a balance. So does the cost of capital go up more than the interest tax shield? And because the market is not 100% efficient, can I exploit the inefficiencies? Because maybe the market will let me borrow the debt at a rate that they shouldn't let me borrow it, and I get to take advantage of all those tax shields and get the cheap debt. And that's what they will often try and exploit. Right? But a lot of companies don't do that because adding debt adds a lot of risk. And a lot of companies aren't willing to take that risk. So again, this is what you get into specialized changing capital structure. But that's the point. If I'm not going to change the capital structure, I'm just going to keep this amount of debt in my business, then it's great. But it doesn't really tell me too much about the change in value of the business because then, therefore, the operating value is going to matter much more. Right? But that would be the APV method. But notice, same answer. You get the same value regardless of the approach.